Now another crucial hour in our history. The big question.
General, if war comes, is this country really ready?
It is not. The administration has spent many billions of dollars for national defense. Yet today, we haven't enough tanks for the fighting in Korea. It is time for a change.
The nation, haunted by the stalemate in Korea, looks to Eisenhower. Eisenhower knows how to deal with the Russians. He has met Europe's leaders, has got them working with us. Elect the number one man for the number one job of our time. November 4th, vote for peace. Vote for Eisenhower. A fake film.
Boy, isn't that something? It's like watching something 100 years old. What's fascinating about that, Julian Kanter, who's director of the Political Commercial Archives, you're also a commodities broker here in the Chicago area, but
yes,
your hobby is to collect this.
That's right, Phil.
Don't you have the largest warehouse of political commercials?
I do, over 8,000 different television political commercials.
You know, you've got some really crazy commercials. Well, we'll talk about those in just a second. You know what's fascinating about that 1952 spot is Republicans in this year's race are saying the same thing about our defense posture today.
Well, many of the issues stay with us, but the form of presentation changes. That spot's very inappropriate for contemporary television because television is a very intimate one-to-one medium. That's more for a newsreel theater.
Ken, you know the guy that said, General, are we ready for war? Looked like a guy who's having a hard time getting a job as an announcer. He looked like an after card-carrying union guy. Which he may have been.
He might have been. I have no way of knowing.
Now, that would be illegal, wouldn't it, in this year? How much control do we
it's
have?
It's not illegal if it carries a slogan of dramatization.
So that when the candidate in his shirt sleeves is standing in the factory parking lot talking...
Those should be factory workers he's talking to.
Could they be extras? Could they be... they can't be. That would be deceptive.
I don't think they can. Not unless they identify it as a dramatization.
Okay. Can we show the Belusi film? A chap by the name of Belusi ran for governor. Georgia?
Georgia.
Okay, watch this. I just want to show you this.
This is Nick Beluso. In the next 10 seconds, you will be hit with a tremendous hypnotic force. You may wish to turn away. Without further ado, let me introduce to you the hypnogenesis of mass hypnosis, the Reverend James G. Masters. Take us away, James.
Do not be afraid. I am placing the name Nick Beluso in your subconscious mind. You will remember this. You will vote on election day. You will vote Nick Beluso for governor. You will remember this. You will vote on election day. You will vote Nick Beluso for governor. You will remember this. You will vote on election day. You will vote Nick Beluso for governor. You will remember this. You will vote on election day. You will vote Nick Beluso for governor. You will remember this. You will remember this.
Can you believe that? That's a no kidding. That's an actual spot, right? Is that right,
Correct.
Julian?
It's a genuine spot for an otherwise unqualified candidate.
We should say that the guy didn't even pronounce his name right. It's Beluso. It was three
right.
syllables. The guy was not elected governor.
No, he
That's
lost
encouraging.
Badly.
All right, let me give you an example now of attack commercials, that is, the nasties. One of the, you'll recall, you remember the daisy, the child pulling the petals of a daisy and the atom bomb goes off? It was a Lyndon Johnson spot, which was intended to smear Goldwater as a warmonger who would drop the bomb in a knee-jerk way. And that wasn't enough. Incidentally, LBJ removed himself from responsibility for this spot, and I don't think he really knew it was happening. But here's the other one. This is LBJ for president, and this is an example of how it gets real nasty in the TV trenches.
Do you know what people used to do? They used to explode atomic bombs in the air. Now, children should have lots of vitamin A and calcium, but they shouldn't have any strontium-90 or cesium-137. These things come from atomic bombs, and they're radioactive. They can make you die. Do you know what people finally did? They got together and signed a nuclear test ban treaty, and then the radioactive poison started to go away. But now, there's a man who wants to be president of the United States, and he doesn't like this treaty. He fought against it. He even voted against it. He wants to go on testing more bombs. His name is Barry Goldwater. And if he's elected, they might start testing all over again.
Vote for President Johnson on November 3rd. The stakes are too high for you to stay home.
You think it's dirty? You don't like that spot, huh? Okay, but what's dirty and who decides? We're going to have a commission? And who elects the commission? You know? All right. Meet Douglas L. Bailey. Mr. Bailey is political planning consultant, president of Bailey, Deerdorf, and Associates. You are the package person. I mean, you help people. You are retained by candidates who are running.
That's my job.
All right. You understand that, first of all, this is not an inquisition, but profession is not held in that high regard, is it, by the public?
I think it's held in very low regard, and to some degree, for good reason. I mean, that kind of commercial that you just saw, frankly, I think is overly dramatic. It was unfair to Barry Goldwater. You say, and I hope you're right, that President Johnson didn't know anything about it. I think sometimes it's true that advertising people have control over a campaign, even to the point that the candidates don't know what's running in their campaigns. I think that's wrong. On the other hand, everybody with my job, which is to help elect the candidates that we're working for, has at some point got to answer this tough question. If there are things about your opponent that you know, and if the public knew, would cause them not to vote for that opponent, do you have the responsibility? Is it appropriate to tell them?
Well, but in what manner should you tell them? I mean, it was generally accepted that Barry Goldwater was a conservative candidate in 1964, and that he was, I think we can say without offending him, a man who perhaps would be more militarily assertive as president. But does it follow that he would be the man who would put strontium 90 in the little girl's ice cream cone?
No, I think it's far more effective, although heaven knows President Johnson won big in that election.
Yes, he did.
But far more effective to treat that issue straightforwardly and just lay out Senator Goldwater's words or have the president on there discussing his side of the issue. Yeah.
We have your agreement that that's a dirty spot, don't we?
I think not only is it dirty from the standpoint of people in my profession, I would conclude that that would be a counterproductive effort on the behalf of
the candidate. Backlash would help the other guy. Right. Look at this one. Here's another one. Texans for Goldwater. This is as nasty as it gets. Texans for Goldwater, 1964.
Let's take a close look at the personal fortune of Lyndon Johnson. He's been a government employee for 33 years. His salary, paid by the American taxpayers, has averaged $14,000 a year. Yet Life magazine conservatively estimates his personal wealth today at $14 million. Where did he get it all? Does Bobby Baker know? How about Billy Saul Estes? Does he have the answer? Surely Walter Jenkins, Lyndon Johnson's closest friend, should be able to tell us. Honestly, it just doesn't add up. We must restore the White House and the office of the presidency as a symbol of respect. We must elect a president we can trust, a man of integrity and honesty. Vote for Barry Goldwater. In your heart, you know he's right.
Now, those who supported Goldwater would say, why not? President Johnson's finances are an appropriate subject of review.
I think that, frankly, violates two of the rules of good political advertising. I think you can have attack and confrontation advertising, but two of the rules of good political advertising are that you don't raise questions that aren't legitimate for which you don't have answers. And that's one thing that was done. And secondly, it implied some things about people and relationships which are wholly inappropriate. I think it is terribly important for people in our business to understand, in terms of effective advertising, that the television is a living room communications vehicle.
Yeah.
And the subject matter and the approach and the emotions that are appropriate in the living room are appropriate on the screen. But if they're not appropriate in the living room, they're not appropriate at all.
Right. Let me just show you one more spot here. This is for J.B. Stoner, who ran for governor of Georgia on states' rights. Is that right?
White supremacy
ticket. This was argued and debated, and many civil rights groups challenged whether or not this ought to air. And the FCC said yes. It came within under the terms of the First Amendment. This is something, all right? J.B. Stoner running for governor of Georgia. Can you imagine sitting around the living room with Grandma in front of the fireplace?
This is J.B. Stoner. Defeat Governor Busby. Busby's state civil rights laws discriminate against white people. Defeat Busby, or he will pass more laws that take from the whites and give to the niggers. Stop discrimination against whites. Love the whites. Repeal Busby's civil rights laws. Restore white rights. Elect white racist J.B. Stoner governor on August 8th.
Preceding announcement paid for by the candidate.
That was, you know, you got to wonder, if that gets by, what's next?
Well, there are two issues involved, Phil. In the first place, as far as his qualification for governor was concerned, he lost badly, which he deserved to. But secondly, as an American citizen, he has first freedom rights, and he exercised those rights in these commercials. And I think that the matter was handled properly by the FCC. The commercial aired, and he got defeated in the polls, which he should have been.
Yeah.
Let me say, Phil, I have a very strong belief that you ought to allow candidates to do anything they want to do, because you ought to have the faith in the public to make a good judgment about those candidates.
Yeah. It's interesting, though, to, without necessarily keying in on it, there's so many promises made during a campaign. I think that everybody who runs for office can look back and perhaps wince a little at the spots that they ran to get there, that the promises made were not fulfilled, or events took over and didn't allow the candidate to...
So listen, sometimes it works the other way. And we've worked with clients who made promises in their television commercials.
Yeah.
And then once they got in office, we'd go back, or their staff would go back and show them those commercials every once in a while and reinforce that promise, because that's the promise they're going to be held to, and so they get the job done.
All right. In point, I'd like to show you this commercial, which was used in the campaign to elect the mayor of Chicago. This commercial is less than a year old. All right? Here's an example, then, of what might be useful for all candidates to do. Sit around and look at their old commercials.
It's not the snow, but good planning can prevent the collapse of public transportation and clean this city up fast. I'm Jane Byrne, Commissioner of Consumer Sales under the late Mayor Daley. He taught me about planning, he taught me about government, and he taught me about people. Everywhere I go, I hear about new problems. Nothing seems to be working the way it used to. I think it's time to get this city moving again. I think it's time to get Chicago working again for you.
Vote for Jane Byrne in the Democratic primary.
I think any politician that takes a cheap shot at another politician shouldn't be running. And I think the people know.
But who decides what's cheap?
I think a politician should have enough brains to know what is going on in his campaign. If he's out for smear, then he shouldn't even be running. And I think people have enough brains to know, and they should decide what is good and what is bad. If you're going to ruin another politician's reputation, then it shouldn't be said.
Well, I think you
true
said it all, though. People are bright enough to know if it's good or bad.
When I'm deciding my vote, I want to hear their outlooks on views, abortion, federal taxes. I don't want to hear about how they couldn't get rid of the snow in Chicago. And I don't want to hear stuff like that. There's one commercial in particular that's on TV today that I think is terrible.
Well, hang on a minute, because I'm afraid it might knock a candidate.
I wouldn't say it. I just, any...
No, I want to...
No, it's against the president. And I think his attitude towards the president is very wrong.
It's somebody running against the president?
Yes.
All right, well, why don't you tell us what the heck? This is America.
Bush's ad.
George Bush's ad.
Ad on against the president. He says, if he gets into office, he wouldn't have to be trained.
Oh, yes, right. A president, we don't have to train. That's right. True. That's
to
the
me,
line.
That's like really knocking down the president quite a few marks. I don't care. If you don't like the man, fine. But you don't have to do that kind of attitude against him.
Okay, can we... Your view is shared by lots of folks, and please don't leave me. I need you for the rest of the show. Thanks for... Just one more, okay? Can we do one more? 1968, Ronnie? 1968, this is for the general election, and Nixon is running against Hubert Humphrey, and this is a spot for Richard Nixon.
Like to say that I really think that every politician should have his time to have a spot on TV, that I do think that it is beneficial to the people. But I also think that there is a place for a cheap shot, and it probably is a place where they'd have an open rebuttal.
In other words,
you know,
yeah.
Two candidates meeting at the same time,
yeah.
Enable, you know, so they can enable themselves to defend themselves at least, but then at least the people know both sides.
Right, but then consider the responsibility you're placing in the hands of the broadcaster. You know, a broadcaster then is obliged to allow a candidate to respond to all attacks of all commercials for all the time. It really gets complicated.
But it's been done.
Yeah. You know what I'd like to see is, I'd like to see them, when we finally get our Republican and Democratic presidential candidates, why don't we just put them in a room alone and let them talk to each other and televise it? I'll give you a chance here. I'll give you a chance. We're talking about political commercials, the impact on the presidency, American politics, money, hype. How do you feel about this? We hope you'll join us. Who's director of the Political Commercial Archives, has the largest collection of political commercials in the world. Douglas Bailey is here. He's a political planning consultant. He's the man you call. And it's expensive. You give us that, huh? I mean, this is expensive what you do.
A major statewide campaign for governor, senator now is almost always $1 million. The advertising almost always runs to $500,000, $600,000 out of that million.
Yeah, I assume this includes a lot of research, et cetera, and...
Research, polling, a lot of filming, editing.
One question that I would like to know is the money, does that come from, like, our income tax? We can contribute $1 from the income tax, or is this strictly, like, from the candidates or from his supporters?
In almost all state campaigns or local campaigns, it is private contributions from you directly to the candidate. In the presidential race, during the primaries, you can give to the candidate, and then the federal government will match a portion of that money to that candidate. And during the general election, after the conventions have picked the nominees, it's all federal money from that fund that is created by you checking off the $1 on your income tax.
I'd like to ask Mr. Bailey, have you ever worked for a man that you didn't believe in?
We never signed a client that we didn't believe in. We got into a couple situations where we soon discovered that the person we thought
we were working for was somebody different than what we had signed on for, and we quit.
One other question. Do you ever use subliminal advertising? Like, say, if Ted Kennedy is running, and if you see him running across the bridge at Chappaquiddick, and all of a sudden you see him sitting in the Oval Office on just one clip, do you ever do that?
No, and technically, you know, there's a device that you can use whereby I can put on the screen. It's illegal. We've never done it, never tried to do it, but I understand that a couple people have at least tried to do it, where you put one frame that says the candidate's name into the middle of a spot. It goes so quickly that your eye, you can't consciously see it, but it registers in your mind. I suppose it's possible, but it's sort of like that hypnotism commercial. It really isn't.
Right.
That guy said, you'll always remember this name, or you won't forget whatever, Bogalusa. Well, I don't think anybody ever will forget Bogalusa who saw that spot, but that doesn't mean anybody's going to vote for him. That's just silly advertising.
You are now working for Howard Baker, is that right?
Correct.
You also worked for Jim Rhodes in 74?
74 and again in 78.
All right, the governor of Ohio. Let's see. This is from the 1974 campaign of James Rhodes as and you were his media consultant. Here's one of your spots.
Right.
Somewhere. It is coming, huh? Somewhere.
At the state fair, Governor Gilligan made what he thought was a funny remark. Asked if he was going to a sheep-shearing contest, Gilligan replied, "I shear taxpayers, not sheep." In fact, the Gilligan administration has just about skinned the hide off the state's working men and women. Thanks to Gilligan, 7 different state taxes have been increased, and his state income tax takes $500 million a year out of taxpayers' pockets. Let's make Governor Rhodes governor again.
What do you think?
That's an interesting commercial because...
That's not the word Gilligan would use.
I'm sure not.
But is it possible he said that in jest and that you picked up a one-line attempt to be humorous and made it into a politically damaging remark?
I assume he did say it in jest.
Well, but that isn't the implication of your spot. The implication of your spot is that this is a nasty guy who wants to shear the taxpayers.
A governor who had sheared the taxpayers.
That's not the point. The point is that...
But factually it is the point. I'm not saying that's a great spot. What I think is important to realize is that Jim Rhodes is an old school politician. It's a good example of what you do in the television age when you have a candidate who is not a great television performer. And if you put Jim Rhodes on television, which we didn't do much in the campaign, there wouldn't be a popular response. He's not Kennedy-esque, he's not charismatic, he just happened to have been a good governor before Gilligan and a good governor since Gilligan.
Yeah. But if those were the rules in 1860, we wouldn't have had Abraham Lincoln.
We'll never know. That may not be true.
Well, Mr. Bailey has indicated that his company never takes a candidate that it doesn't believe in. If that is true, then you must go through some sort of a screening program for applicants, because if your company is successful or has a track record of being successful, then you must be bombarded with candidates who want to run.
There's such a thing in this business as sort of a hot property every 2 years. Naturally, clients or the candidates will go to the firm that has had successes in the previous year. We've developed that kind of reputation. What that means for us is that we have an awful lot of people knocking on the door, and it gives us some chance for a little flexibility in picking and choosing. We're interested, we don't put labels on candidates. We're not looking for conservative or liberal. We're looking for people that we can feel comfortable with and that are, first and foremost, not reflex thinkers of any
kind.
But
how do you go about deciding? Because unless you personally have contact with them, then you have to, do you do research to delve through their track record, or...
We do quite a bit of research. We do a lot of talking with them.
But if I've got the money and my checks don't bounce, I mean, how principled are you going to be?
We can afford to be pretty principled.
Could you support?
Because the fact of the matter is we can't work for more than 6 or 7 clients at a time. We have probably 35, 40 potential clients knocking on the door so that we can pick and choose a little bit.
You're now working for Howard Baker, and that spot was your product for James Rhodes, both of whom are Republican.
I don't think
that neither would be offended if I just generally refer to them as conservative politicians in the nicest way. So my question is, would you accept an assignment from Gary Hart of Colorado, or...
We've had very few Democrats knock on the door. We have worked for some Democrats, former mayor of Louisville, and some people in Washington, D.C.
So you can,
principally
then,
a Republican.
You can work both sides of the political street.
You can, but you become a little suspect.
All right.
And a lot of people won't hire you if you seem to be flip-flopping all over the place.
Ronnie, can we just see one more example of an attack spot? This is another political commercial in the column of attacking the opponent, huh? All right. Roll film. Political commercials, do they help?
In Washington, the U.S. Senate meets to vote on critical legislation. But the junior senator from California is absent. In fact, while California families worked hard to make ends meet this summer, California's absent senator failed to vote 100 times. 100 times in just 9 weeks. Let's give California a full-time senator.
It worked. Senator Hayakawa was elected over Tunney. Senator
That's
Tunney.
Correct.
We'll be back in just a moment.
Hi, it's Harriet.
Afraid we will. That's if you joined us late, an actual political commercial. And this is the year where we're going to see more and more political spots. We're talking about it, trying to analyze it and figure out whether it's good for us.
Okay, I feel my vote is very, very important. And I do not see why my time should be wasted on such petty garbage as one candidate bringing in slop from another guy's yard. Why don't you emphasize your candidate's good, positive qualities?
Because sometimes attacking is more effective.
That's disgusting.
I mean, it may be disgusting, and I agree with you that some of the stuff we've seen, and perhaps some of the stuff that everybody in this business does, is disgusting. And they may wish a few years later that they hadn't done it. But when you're in a campaign, if you've ever worked in a political campaign and you are behind, what do? Do you sit there and go down to defeat, or do you rock the boat in what you feel? In what you feel.
You give it your best
in what
for what you,
feel
you have
are legitimate,
right here. You don't
are legitimate
smear somebody else.
What is a smear and a comparison with your opponent, or is a smear an unfair attack on your opponent?
It is an unfair attack. I mean, so far, that's all we've seen this morning.
But what Doug is saying is that oftentimes the candidate who chooses to attack his opponent is making points he thinks are legitimate and valid and the things that the voters should keep in consideration when they make up their minds.
Then can it be done in a much more tactful way than bringing in a
It can be done in various ways, but the purpose of the commercial is twofold. The purpose of the commercial from the standpoint of the candidate is to win supporters or cause his opponent to lose supporters. The purpose of the commercial from the standpoint of our elective process is to enable us as voters to have some kind of meaningful information based on which to make up our minds on election day. And if some candidate gives us nothing but garbage, that person doesn't deserve our vote on election day. If they give us reasons why we shouldn't support his opponent and why we should support him, then I think that person has given us two kinds of reasons to support his or her candidacy.
Are there no controls over these political commercials? The FCC seems to control commercials for everything else. Are there any controls on these political?
The federal law is very clear that a candidate can do anything that candidate wants to do, with the exception of violating codes on words.
Profanity and then laws of libel would govern everything
libel
else.
Libel and slander.
Yeah, but try and get a libel judgment in a political campaign.
Very,
I mean, it's almost impossible.
Almost impossible.
Let me just show you an example of direct to the voters. Now, if you've got the charisma, or if you're thought of as good-looking and so on, then obviously your media guy is going to say, you get on the air and you do it. Can I see number 7, Ronnie? This is an example of a political spot from some years ago, 1960.
We have to prepare for automation. When one machine takes the place of 5 men, what's going to happen to those 5 men? Men with good education, advanced education, are in great demand. Those that have not had the benefit of that education, they're the ones that are hard hit. We have to make it possible for all of our children to be well educated. Nearly 35% of our brightest boys and girls never see the inside of a college classroom. That's a waste of a national resource and a great waste of an individual resource. Education, studies, and careful research on automation to make it fruitful rather than harmful. Vocational retraining, recognizing that this is a land of opportunity, and we have to make sure that that opportunity is shared by all of our fellow citizens. I can assure you that if we're successful in this election, we're going to go to work. we're going to start this country moving again.
For leadership in the 60s, vote for John F. Kennedy for president.
All right, that's an example of direct to the voter, which now enters showbiz. Now watch this, same candidate, same campaign, but we're going to dress it up a little bit with a little more razzmatazz, and which is then the better or more effective of the two spots, the one you just saw or this one? What do you think? Yeah.
I think that all these commercials have a place, and I think they shouldn't be censored because they totally reflect the candidate. This tells you exactly what they're like if they're going to be...
You're saying they should not be censored?
No, I don't think so.
In other words, let them go, and if they get dirty, they'll follow their own way.
Well, let them make a fool of themselves, because most of these, you think less of the candidate who is presenting them. They lose support.
Yeah, but this is hindsight, too. Let's not forget that.
Oh, no, that's not true, because I see lots of commercials today for things, and you think, oh, what an idiot. You know, the person who was putting in the commercial.
I think that's absolutely right. Most candidates who go to negative advertising go to negative advertising because their campaign is in trouble. And it gets into worse trouble because they've gone to negative advertising because people generally don't like it.
And we'll be back in just a moment.
Here's the entertainment value of the season. One of the world's great superstars in an exclusive TV offer. TV Records presents the incomparable Engelbert Humperdinck with 20 of his greatest hits.
Please release me, let me go.
Here on two stereo records or 8-track tape is the definitive collection of Engelbert's greatest hits. This special TV offer is not available in any store. You can get Engelbert's 20 greatest hits only if you act now.
Let me say, Claire. Carry us side by side.
I can wait a moment more.
Engelbert's 20 greatest hits contains all his biggest. You'll get Last Waltz, Release Me, Spanish Eyes, and A Man Without Love.
To hold me every day I wake up and I start to break up. Lonely as a man without love.
In all, you get 20 of Engelbert's super hits on two stereo records or 8-track tape.
There goes my reason for living.
And remember, this special TV offer is not available in any store. You can get Engelbert 20 greatest hits only if you act now.
Spanish eyes.
And here's how to order.
To order, call toll-free 1-800-835-2246, 1-800-835-2246. Save COD charges, send $7.99 for records, $8.99 for 8-track tape to Engelbert, Box 700, Boston, Massachusetts, 02117. Engelbert, Box 700, Boston, or call 1-800-835-2246. Order yours today.
This is really instructive, I think, looking back and taking political commercials. Let's go to 1968 now. Can I just show you this, and then I've got to get this audience in the act. Roll film. A candidate for president, 1968. How do you feel about this?
It isn't easy to grow up in today's complex America. Our children will need twice the number of schoolrooms in their generation. There will be twice the number of cars on the road. Pollution of our air and lakes and rivers may make parts of the land unlivable. Whether or not our children make it depends on who cares about them today. They need people who care in the right places. Robert Kennedy is a man who cares.
F. Kennedy. Here's another spot. Same candidate, same campaign, 1968. And this is a different approach to winning votes. Which is it is fervently hoped will be shown on this program today. All right. Okay. Here it is.
Sure, the people understand that we care.
We should give money to all the...
This man has always been in close touch with young people. And he's never underestimated their ability to understand the present or to face up to the future.
More white people than black people.
There's a lot
of poverty you don't see, you know, hear so much about, which is in the rural areas of the country. And I think the government can play a role in that, but I think also private industry can play an important role. And I think there has to be a partnership of private industry and government, a kind of a partnership that doesn't exist at the moment. And that we are going to put into effect programs which will have some effect on their lives, namely that so people can find jobs. And that they will have some control over their own future. And they'll have some say in their own future.
Kennedy for president. Nebraska can make the difference.
What was the point you wanted to make, Mr. Kanter?
Phil, I wanted to establish, first of all, that with respect to that jingle spot for Bob's older brother, John, there were in excess of 150 different commercials of all lengths made for the Kennedy campaign in 1960. A 60-second version and the 20-second version of the jingle we just saw were the only two that did not deal specifically with issues. It was an identification spot. It was just a jingle to call attention to Kennedy's name. So his television commercials were, in fact, informative throughout, with the exception of the one jingle. The two spots we just saw for Bob Kennedy both dealt with really very much the same subject matter, but presented in dramatically different ways. The first one was a symbolic or representational spot, trying to capture the interest and the attention of the viewer while the announcer, voiceover, explains to you what it is he wants to say.
That's the steps.
That's the steps,
toys.
A little child pulling up the toy bus. The second spot showed Bob Kennedy engaged in direct conversation with young children in a classroom, both of them dealing with the same subject, the emphasis on the second one being on an effort to display Bob Kennedy's feeling for children, his personality, and his character.
Mm-hmm. Do you ever, do you not, Mr. Bailey, some of those... Those corner street conferences with the voters?
Yeah, it's called in the business cinema verite. Do you mean man in the street commercials or with
no,
the candidate?
Where the candidate's talking to the farmer and the... So.
It's known in the business as sort of cinema verite, that is, truth in film. And what is done is rather than scripting a 30-second spot in advance, you put the candidate in the middle of a group of construction workers or what have you, or school children, and film for an hour, and then reach into that film and pull out the 30 seconds or 60 seconds which best captures right. issues, personality, and so
but
forth.
But the people who are involved are usually know they're involved in the preparation of a political spot, do they?
They
not?
Do that, but they're not professional actors, and generally we've found anyway that it is best to get people involved in those sessions who are not supporters of the candidate, but who have genuine questions or disagreements
yes.
with the candidate, so you get some live discussion and real action.
Right, but I mean, if somebody, the point is that you select the material that's to be seen.
Of course.
All right.
Commercials are commercials.
Yes, they are. Yes, they are. But we're talking not about soap now. We're talking about a man who may or may not take us to war, who's going to make decisions under pressure. My goodness. And he is being presented to us with all the warts taken out.
Phil, there are two kinds of television political communication. One is the free kind, covered by the networks and the stations. They control it. They put the candidate on when they want to. They cover that portion of the campaign they choose to. The candidate, in his own right, buys time, whether it's for spots or for longer program commercials, in which he tries to put his best foot forward and remove as many warts from his face as he can. That's the way our system works.
I'm not a big fan of negative advertising, but one of the reasons that you find it is just what you described. It is my job for my client
yeah.
to put the best face forward of that client.
Yeah.
But if I'm putting the best face forward, then who's describing the warts? The other guy describes my candidate's warts. I describe his candidate's warts.
All right. We'll be back in just a moment.
Hey, big fella!
Huh? Agencies ever take a poll of what the audience is like to hear, these negative campaigns or these positive type issues?
Political campaigns these days always live with polls, maybe too many polls. And most campaigns that have the money will find some way of pre-testing the advertising before it goes on the air.
Not much time.
I'd like to know how many of the ladies feel that their intelligence is insulted by a lot of these commercials that are really dumb.
Thank you.
Mr. Bailey, could a major political candidate today win without television commercials?
Not if his opponent is running television. It is the dominant fact of life in politics.
Yes.
Well, they better not be poor, or they'll never make it.
That's
they
correct.
Might have a lot of good priorities, but...
The biggest problem in politics is not television. It's the fact that television dominates politics, and you've got to have money to have television, which means rich candidates.
Here's an example of what I think you think is a good spot, huh? This one here, number 11.
Right.
Okay, here's roll tape. What do you think of this? 1966.
Before Governor Rockefeller came into office, there was no statewide minimum wage. He made it a dollar. Four years later, when the price of the minimum meal went up, Governor Rockefeller put the minimum wage up to $1.25. And now that everything's gone up again, he's raised the minimum wage again. Next New Year's Day, it will become $1.50.
Well, maybe not. You really think so, huh? Well, it worked. He was reelected, yes.
I was just going to say, you've convinced me that these political things are not necessary. They asked at the beginning, because I think the television and the papers have proved that they want the people to hear only what they want to hear.
Wow.
And I watched Jane Byrne when she was on this show, and the next day I read what she said in the paper, and I would say at least 35% of it was absolutely not true. After listening to her one day and reading what she said the next day, I was really appalled. And that's what the American people are getting today. Exactly what you want them to hear or read.
Well, but that's going to be the way it is with television advertising. You're not really expecting a man to pay a price for showing his warts, huh?
I think that you talk about negative campaigns. I think that all your films were very negative, too. I don't think they were very good films. I'm sorry.
Well, the last one wasn't bad, was it?
Well, I don't know if he didn't say if that was his or not. Was
all right, let's run a test here. Youngstein. Youngstein for mayor of New York. She was not a major party candidate.
Free libertarian.
Okay, but we're getting a little more sophisticated. 1973, New York City, mayoralty race. What do you think of this spot?
I'm Fran Youngstein. I'm running for mayor of New York, but I won't try to convince you I'm the best one to run your life. The other candidates say trust them. I say trust only yourself. Taxation is theft. Spend your money as you see fit. Laws restricting pornography, drug use, and homosexuality have no place in a free society and should be repealed. What you do with your body is your business. Don't waste your vote. Vote Youngstein for mayor and tell City Hall, leave me alone.
Well, I don't have any opinion on that one. Although she is telling you what she feels is right, and I give her a lot of credit for that.
Well, she gets a lot of credit from you and no victory, because she didn't win.
Because she's a woman, probably.
I have one comment to make as a layman. I'm a farm boy.
Yeah, so little time.
So little time. I think it's a very dangerous thing. There are such magnitudes of wealth in certain industries and certain peoples that this could be used, and we could develop a Hitler situation if it was exaggerated.
Well, there are a lot of critics who will tell you there are not a whole lot of poor people in the Senate today. Can we just see one more? Can't, huh? I try so hard. We'll be back in just a moment.
It's like floating in space, the Niagara adjustable bed with cyclomassage units. The Niagara bed adjusts automatically to support your head, back, and legs. Watch TV, read, write, eat, and sleep in bed 4 hours in posture-correct comfort.
At script of today's program, send $2.50 in check or money order to Donahue Transcripts, Box 2111, Cincinnati, Ohio 45201. Include the subject or the name of the guest with your request.